Thank you. Kiss to build a dream on, and my imagination will thrive upon that kiss. Sweetheart, I ask no more than this, a kiss to build a dream on. Give me a kiss before you leave me, and my imagination will feed my hungry heart. Leave me one thing before we part, a kiss to build a dream on. When I'm alone with my fancies, I'll be with you, weaving romances, making believe they're true. Oh, give me your lips for just a moment, and my imagination will make that moment live. Give me what you alone can give, a kiss to build a dream on.
Good evening. I'm Jerry Beckman, Assistant Head of School for Academic Affairs here at Randolph School. Thank you for joining us for rallying together for students, families, and our community. We're excited to engage with parents and families within the Randolph School community and across North Alabama. Like you, we're missing that in-person connection, but we're embracing these opportunities to gather and connect on digital platforms. We'd like to thank our event sponsor, Silver Linings Neurodevelopment, as well as Metropolitan Disc Jockey for providing the live stream services. As a reminder, this is the second of four events in the Rallying Together series that we will host every Tuesday night during the month of February at 6:30 p.m. If you haven't already, you can register for the upcoming events on randolphschool.net. Please join me in welcoming Kristin Scroggin. Kristin can't do math or bake a pie, but she is a great speaker. Kristin has her master's degree in communication studies and a bachelor's degree in communication arts. As a communication lecturer at the University of Alabama in Huntsville since 2007, she has been able to research hundreds of millennials and Gen Z members. She started her own training company, Gen Y Communications, in 2017. Her passion is generational diversity and all things soft skill related. She has spoken at conferences to hundreds of organizations across the United States, ranging from Fortune 500 companies to tiny nonprofits. Obsessed with travel and desperate to see the world, she and her husband try to keep their heads above water while parenting their four children and any foster children who come their way. Give a warm welcome to Kristin Scroggin.
Thanks so much, Jerry. All right, well, I'm excited to be here with you guys tonight, and I have a question for you right out of the blue, especially to my live audience members here. Have you ever looked around your table, looked at your family, and thought, why am I the only normal person here? Has anyone ever had that moment where you look at the kids and you think, how did I make you? Right? Or you look at your parents and you're like, why? What is wrong with you? Right? Families are weird because people are weird. And my goal today is to help you understand why people are weird from a generational perspective. Now, there's lots of ways people are weird with personality. There's lots of ways people are weird with their backgrounds. But we are going to focus specifically on one little level of people, and that's specifically the age you are, the generation that you are born in. So whether you are joining us live or whether you are joining us virtually, I'm super excited to be here with you. And I hope that you spend the next hour to hour and a half, depending on questions, making sure that you get some answers that can help you understand one another a little bit better. Because when we understand each other better, we spend a lot less time being mad. And that's my life goal for you today, is to maybe hate your family just a little less. Does that sound like a good use of your time? Awesome. Okay. As he told you, my name is Kristin Scroggin. I am currently a professor at the University of Alabama in Huntsville, and I teach communication arts there. And I also have my little side gig, my side hustle, like every Gen X in the world has, that allows them to do a little something on the side. And I started studying the millennials when I started teaching because they were just so weird. And I was like, how do I not kill these people? And so I started studying them from a purely selfish reason. And then before long, I was like, okay, I'm getting it. And then companies started coming to me and saying, tell me why my people are this way. And so that's what I've been doing pretty much nonstop for the past 2 years. As you can imagine, COVID was not an awesome thing for a professional speaker, kind of shut things down, but we've been doing quite a lot of virtual webinars, which I'm totally available to do for you guys, and I love doing for Randolph. This is my third one with Randolph so far, and I spoke to many of your 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th graders, and go ask them if they haven't talked to you today and they said what happened at school today and said nothing, you say, hey, I know that you had a class today with Miss Scroggin. So that'll give you a conversation to get started with. All right, there's a few things you need to know about generations before we get too deep into this. The first thing is that we are on a pendulum, okay? And we are constantly swinging between extremes in any culture, anywhere around the world. We're always somewhere between these two places. So think about this for those of you that are parents, okay? You think about the things that your parents did that you like, and you move that into the way you parent your own children. So this is how things like morals and values and traditions, all of those things happen because you liked those, and so you moved them into the way you parented. But what do you do for anything you don't like about the way your parents parented? You go into the extreme opposite direction. And how a child is parented has a lot to do with how their generation develops. And that's specifically what we look at, is your childhood, what was happening, and of course most of our research is from an American perspective because it's by far the easiest to research. And so we're looking at things like, were we at war? How was the economy? What was going on with parental structures? What kind of things were happening in movies and music? And the more we look at that, the more we can begin to kind of put little boxes around people, right? And say, this group goes together. So when you put parenting styles, which are culturally driven, right? You think about the Pinterest parent of today, right? There's rules and norms that we are supposed to have that come along with each one of our parenting groups. So just know we're always in a pendulum, okay? We as a culture will see the best and worst of humanity over at least 100-year span, right? So no matter how bad things are, chances are it's going to pivot to really good before too long. Everybody got that? So no matter how horrible your kids are right now, chances are they might still turn out okay. This is maybe the most important thing I have to say to you today. You're not that special. Now, this is difficult. And listen, even when I talk to NASA, I still hit them in the face with this. Because the bottom line is that you can be categorized. In the United States, we like to pretend like we're all oh so shiny diamonds and there's nobody just like us, but that's just crap. Right? Everybody knows somebody. Like, there is somebody you work with and you can't remember that joker's name because they remind you so much of someone else. And they're like, I'm Bob. And you're like, you're Brad to me. Right? We naturally see this. We see these things repeated. And that's why we say things like, you're so much like your dad, or you're acting just like your mom right now. Right? We see these patterns that are repeated. And that's always going to happen. Right? Because we can be categorized. So, for those of you in here and those of you that are live, have you ever taken a personality test before? Anybody in here have taken a personality test before? Okay, so here's the thing. If you told the truth on that, when the answers came back, you were probably like, oh my God, this is so accurate. Like, this is stuff I've never told anyone. Honey, read this. You need to know who I really am. Didn't you do that? Now, here's the thing. If we can take the most complicated part of a person, their personality, and turn it into an ENFP or a DISC or a red or a blue or a yellow or a green or a Gryffindor, Hufflepuff, Ravenclaw, Slytherin, you're not that special. We can categorize you. Everybody got that? Because if you get obsessed in your mind that I'm too different, I can't be categorized, then you'll miss the opportunity to learn key elements of each one of the generations. Okay? Now, it is possible that you don't fit within your generation. This happens all the time, and it's based on basically how many adult things you had to do as a child. Okay? You mentally age up or down. So this, you guys, this is how we come up with the idea of old souls. Do any of you know anybody that's an old soul? And they're like 27 and they really like knitting and brandy, right? And you're like, what, how? How did we get this way? That happens usually because they're an old soul. And there's all kinds of factors that we're not going to spend tons of time on this that makes you what's called an outlier. Now, we're in Huntsville, land of the engineers. And so you should know about outlying statistics. And when you are doing some sort of research and an outlying statistic happens, what do? You throw it out. You act like it never even existed. So if you are that special, my dear friend, I'm not even talking about you tonight. Chances are you're not, right? But if you have imagined yourself that way, there's going to be something like you were raised by a single parent, almost always puts you in an outlier category. You're from a small town. You didn't have just one mom. You had 31 moms in a small town, right? Everybody has permission to whoop you. Okay? There's all these sort of things. Raised by your grandparents or heavy grandparent influence. You got off the bus to mama and peepaws and they, you know, they taught you how to do all this and how to shake hands and kiss babies and the rules of the business. So that's how outliers go. So it is possible for you to be in an age group and share some characteristics, but also share most of your characteristics with a group older than you. Okay? And if you're in a company where you're working, the people that you supervise, the people you are around all day, every day, are significantly younger than you, then what happens is over time, the more time you spend around them, the more you begin to age down. Everybody with me on that? So it's possible. This is how we get those baby boomers who are tech aficionados, right? No problem with being able to move to systems whatsoever. If they are managing a lot of millennials, they learn how to adapt very quickly, okay? So you're not that special, but you might be an outlier. But if you're an outlier, I'm not talking about you anyway, okay? Now, chances are you are convinced that your sweet baby is an outlier. And they're probably not, right? They probably do fit most of these things. So if I can help you understand why they are doing these particular behaviors, then you might realize, number one, it's not your fault. And number two, that it is something that is a collective viewpoint that is based on their particular generation, okay? Another thing that's really important for you to understand when it comes to generations is that we removed over time. So what happens is, remember we talked about the idea of the pendulum? And that in America has a tendency to pivot on the idea of being very collectivistic and then moving towards being very individualistic. And then all getting back, right? Some sort of calamity happens and we all have to get back on the same team. And we swing very quickly back and then we get more and more and more and more individualistic. So for example, we kind of run the gamut in our American workplaces right now, because you still have traditionalists at least sitting on the board of companies, right, who are very hyper-collectivistic, one for all and all for one, and then you have millennials who are as far as we could possibly see on the level of individualism. Okay, and what we're seeing is right now with Gen Zs and Gen Alphas, we're starting to come back down towards the middle. And of course, COVID has hurried that along significantly faster. When we're in catastrophe, we will move the pivot more quickly. Okay, but here's one of the things you have to understand. When we are collectivistic, okay, the best way I can describe it to you is like a diamond. Okay, you with me on this? So that diamond there on the left, does it have value? Yeah. Do you want it in that condition? No. You want it like the diamond on the right. You want it shined up. But here's the thing. It takes time and energy and experts and different things to get that diamond like the diamond on the right. So here's the problem. In American culture, we have removed, as we have become more individualistic, we have removed outside adults from having the ability to take our children down a peg. Right? To just refine their personality a little bit. So the older you are, I'm going to use you example, baby boomers, you had people telling you were crappy all the time, right? Your coaches told you were garbage. Your teachers told you were never going to amount to anything, right? The kid neighbor was like, you rotten kid. You had people all the time that were teaching you and refining you, and you had first jobs at 15 where you had to scrub the toilet even though you were the employee of the month. You had all these people around you. And what's happened as we've become more and more individualistic in our swing is we have removed refiners from our children's lives. Okay? So when you remove refiners and you, the parent, are the only one who's ever giving any edge blow, right, over to your kid, you're the only one doing any refining, if you think your precious angel is perfect, you're probably not refining them. So what's happening is, in our workplaces, and I speak to a lot of companies, and they'll tell you what's been happening is, they've got people coming in more looking like the diamond on the left, when they came in looking like the diamond on the right, already polished up. They knew how to get places on time. They knew how to respect even if they didn't agree, right? They learned all these kind of things through other people. The culture taught that. And as we have removed those people, where people don't even know their neighbors, right? Much less let them yell at their kid, then we have taken that away. Again, that will begin to swing. We already see that happen. Like, I have a lot of friends now who say, I have a village of parents, right? And I tell my kid, if they go over to their house, just rip them. If they act stupid, feel free to tell them that they're acting stupid, right? But that's a huge departure from what those flower children did to their early millennial children. Everybody follow me on that? Okay. So the bottom line is that we have fewer refiners, and so we're getting less polished. So who you were as an eighth grader, to use the examples today, had significantly more polishing from outside resources for people who are Gen Xers, baby boomers, and traditionalists than what millennials, Gen Zs, and, right? Everything, hear me, everything you don't like about the new generation, we created. Every single bit of it. Right? There is not a single child, there is not a single millennial you will ever meet in your life who woke up one morning when they were seven and were like, please God, let me win 11th place this year. None of them. That's not even the nature of America. We're hyper-competitive, right? And so this idea of parental norms and parenting changes the way that we've been reacting. Everybody get this concept? It's not all you. There's cultural influences here. Okay. I'm going to give you a second to look at this screen because you will just compulsively look at it if I don't. So I need you to figure out a couple things. Number one, I need you to figure out where you are, which generation you are called by. Where's your partner? Okay. Where's your parents? Where's your children? And where is the employee that you have that you most want to punch in the throat? Okay. This will help you. That gives you the full gamut of people to be able to work with. Everybody got that? You at least know where you are because that's the most important. Okay. When you look over here to your left, you're seeing the way that people commonly lay out generations. Now hear me. You will always see different numbers when it comes to any kind of generational research. This is mostly because academics have to publish to keep their job. It's not because it actually matters, okay? We took our numbers from the originators of generational theory, Strauss and Howe are their names, and then we began doing the research to see how often people actually fell into those categories. And that's how we came up with our particular numbers. But don't freak out if you go look at this later and Pew Research has millennials starting at 1980, which they always do. But listen, I've talked to thousands of millennials and there's a big difference between kids that were born in 1980 and kids that were born in 1986. A massive difference between those people. Okay, so that's what we started to kind of look at. So on the left, you're seeing the 20-year divide. Here's the problem. If we're looking at parenting norms and we're looking at culture, if we lump people together in a 20-year group, it's not going to be indicative of how people actually are, is it? Okay, example, baby boomers. The older baby boomers were raised in the 1950s, and the younger baby boomers were kids of the 1960s. Did the United States of America look the same in the 50s as it did in the 60s? No. So this is why so often people in the younger half of a generation ignore all generational information as nonsense. Because our tendency is to only research the first wave of a generation. Okay? We have the big brother and they set the terms for what the little brother is going to be like. Okay? So that's why we begin moving it into micro generations by looking at what kind of events would trigger parenting change. Okay? So for example, would you say that COVID is going to change the way that people parent? I'm telling you, those new kids that are going to be born are going to grow up washing their hands significantly more than my 9-year-old ever will. Right? Would you say that the Great Depression triggered a difference in how we parented? How about the internet? How about the civil rights movement? Right? All of these things trigger parenting change. So that's what we're looking for, is what kind of event would form a micro pivot, right, within a generation so that you can begin dividing them up. So that's how we came up with our particular numbers. Okay? Another thing that's really interesting about generations, you'll love this, is it's almost like when you have a sibling group of two and you have the older sibling and the younger sibling, right? The older sibling is the one that comes in, they're like, break down the door, right? Like, I'm going to come in and I'm going to change things. And so on the first half of a generation, they normally impact the economy drastically. They deal with what kind of work we do. So think about the dot-com boom. That was the Gen Xers, right? It was the first half of that generation that was the dot-com boom. Right? And you think about baby boomers. They came in and they were, woo, changing things up. The second half of a generation consistently changes the social part of a country. So the first part deals with the economy, and right, they deal with what kind of work we do, and the second part deals with who gets to work. right? And so you see this happening over and over and over again. So let's just use millennials and Gen Z, and then even into a little bit into Gen Alpha, right? So some of your kids are going to fall into those different categories. So millennials come in, right? And they're like, yeah, I'm not coming to work at 7:30. Pass. Right? And you're like, yes, you will. And they're like, no, I won't. And you can't turn on your computer, so what you gonna do, right? Right? They were able to make all kinds of changes. And it's so funny because there are millennials across the country who are just cackling right now because they had been saying for years to their boss, we could totally be doing this from home. We could totally be saving so much money on building and trash cans and lights. And then, why don't we save money and you just put it into my salary? And everybody was like, no, butts in chairs. Right? And then those companies that were listening to those millennials were able to very agilely pivot when COVID hit. They were able to move very, very fast. And all the millennials were like, ha, 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 told you. Right? So they changed very much how we're working, what kind of work's going to be done. A lot of teledoctoring, and right? A lot of that's going to come out of those early formers as COVID kind of busts up even more. A lot of them are likely to become entrepreneurs. That almost always happens right after tragedy. And they just start, man, busting things up. And a whole new wave of stuff comes in. But you might have seen, right, if you were watching anything about the Black Lives Matter protest, the majority of people who were there were 23, 22, 21, 20. Right? They were the young people. When you think about the gun protest that came out in Florida, do you remember when the high school had the shot and there was a huge movement that happened? They were all Gen Zs. They weren't millennials. Millennials were living in their parents' basement and working their first jobs. Right? It's the second half that moves social change. So that means it's very interesting for you that have students here right now, because you are dealing with Gen Zs who are going to have a very big responsibility because they're going to be on the front end of the 80-year cycle pivot, right? They're going to change all of that, and they're going to be responsible for who gets to work and how fair it is. We're going to see this kind of emerge along the way. So, heavy is the head that wears the crown. You have a responsibility because it's going to have an impact for the next 80 to 100 years minimum. All right, so that's that. So we're going to divide into those big main areas, right? Traditionalists, silent, baby boomers. And we're going to talk about each one of these just a little bit as we go through so you can see some key differences that have a tendency to surface. Flower children. Flower children most want you to know that they are not like their big brothers. The most recent AARP survey says that right about 40% of the older baby boomers plan to die at their desk. No intention of retiring whatsoever, right? The second half of that generation would love to retire, but the economy keeps kicking them in the face. Right? The people who are truly in the sandwich generation are the flower children. Their parents' medical expenses are more than they ever thought could be possible, and their children still live in their basement. Right? So they're the ones that are like, every day, that's part of why you see people in this age range that have a tendency to do the time to make the donuts, right? Like, they're ready to go, but they can't. And then you've got Gen Zs and Zennials that are like, at 57, I'm out. Deuces, bye. I will sell all grandma's china, your china, my china. We move into Costa in a tiny house, and I don't care if I ever see my grandchildren. Bye. Right? It's just a very different, because pendulum swing. Do you get this? Because those Gen Xers, their parents were working all the time, right? They decided, I'm never missing anything my children do ever. And so they go to the extreme direction. Okay? Everybody with me? So for the majority of people, I would imagine online and in the room, if we're just talking about from a parenting standpoint, you probably have kids that, you might have some older kids that fall into the millennial category. You probably have Gen Zs. That's definitely going to be a lot of your your seniors in high school, seniors and juniors right now. And you might even notice that in your own house, your seniors and juniors are very different than your sophomores and freshmen. Like, there's a very clear divide that sort of happens between those two groups of people. The newest group that we've got out there right now that is called Generation Alpha, and they're really the babies, the three-year-olds, are called Homelanders, but that's stupid. We only call a generation by their name when they begin calling themselves something. Until then, we just call them by letter. Okay? So right now they've named them Gen Alpha. They will never go by that. Chances are this will be the people who get called. The ones I've heard the most frequently floated around is Quarantineagers or Coronials or Zoomers. I've heard that one a lot too. Zoomers is the other one. Whatever it is, this next group is going to be heavily, heavily impacted by what COVID has done to, it will rearrange the school system and how their parents work, and so many things will change and pivot during their childhood in a way that the other generations would have said, no, absolutely not. It'll never happen. And then you've got the Homelanders, which is just a stupid name. but it's the kids that have never lived in a world without homeland security is basically the way that we get that. But again, a generation is not a generation until they call themselves that. Everybody follow that concept? And this is why Gen Z, the millennial name, had such a horrible, horrible concept that's been assigned to it, that the Gen Zs were like, yeah, we're not. Mm-mm. So they just went downstairs and they stole their little brother's name. Originally, the Gen Alphas were called Gen Zs, but enough Gen Zs began calling themselves Gen Zs. And so originally they were called iGen, like iPad, iMac, i whatever. They were originally called iGen. Okay, everybody got this. You get this idea that this is who we are. Okay, so this is, we're going to go immediately into a poll now that you've seen a little bit about polls. Those of you that are online, if you have your cell phones, or even those of you that are, who are in the room, you can text to 22333, and then in the actual message part, you are going to write rschool482, and then you're going to pick which generation frustrates you the most. Is it going to be traditionalist A, baby boomers B, C, Gen X, D, millennials, E, Gen Alphas? All right, I'm going to give you a second to get those in, and we'll see what comes online. Have you got it still? It's going to be a little bit slower than it was for the high school students. All of us are like, I didn't bring my reading glasses, honey. What does it say? You can also go to polleverywhere.com. Yeah, there's one. Our school 482. Those of you online, definitely hope you're participating along with us. Which generation frustrates you the most, makes you talk through your teeth? Kids today or grown-ups today? Come again? I think you can only vote once on the way this poll is designed. Sorry. You're just going to start pushing everybody. Everyone but me. Awesome. All right, we got a little numbers coming in here. If you're still working on it, if you don't want to do this, life will go on. It's just a little fun way to make sure you're still awake. Here comes some Gen Xers in there. Ooh. Oh, now they're coming. So y'all had to have been here for the eighth graders earlier this morning, because the minute that whatever they had voted for, they started cheering for. It became like a weird race. And they were like, yeah, hey, oh, boo, 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 hey. I mean, like, it was bonkers.
Did they vote on the same?
They did one based on how they handle conflict. So they did one on do you just attack it and let it rip and say what you want to say, or do you run away and pretend like it never happened? And it ended up in this particular eighth grade group, it ended up being I just rip it and stick it. I just say what I want to say. I'm like, yeah, that'll quiet down a little in ninth grade. All right, so that kind of gives us a good idea. Everybody's irritated with everyone except for the old people, right, at this point. Unless we just pat them on the hand and we're like, oh, dear. But if you were having to be their full-time caretaker, you might be saying something a little bit different. But shocker of all shockers, millennial and Gen Zs are probably going to be the ones who are going to highlight. And that is honestly because they are the most different from us. right? We've been sort of varying a little bit at a time, and then millennials kind of came in and they just flipped the board over and said, this is sort of not the universe that we're wanting. And because they're huge, and this is important, because they're huge, they've been able to make major changes. All right, can you get me back over there? Oh, there's a little Gen Z coming in hot at the end. I might be the Gen Z that they're referring to. Don't talk about me like that. Okay? Beautiful. Okay, so let's kind of take this down to a little bit more of how different groups get influenced, okay? So if this was the previous census, because in case you didn't know, we still don't have census numbers 100% in. They're supposed to be coming. I'll be the only person excited. But here's how the previous census broke us down into generations. About 6.8% of the American population are traditionalist, and then you've got baby boomers at 22.7%. Baby boomers, you are not 64% of the American population anymore. You lived hard. Y'all used to put motor oil on your bodies to live out in the sun. You hitchhiked across the country, right? You lived hard. So as much as you don't want to deny it with all your Botox, the bottom line is you are aging more rapidly than the other people. Then you've got Gen Xers, which are right about 24%. That's very deceiving because we're actually a very small generation, but because we're mostly in our 40s and 50s, we're just not having as many medical difficulties as people in their 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s are. And then you've got Millennials and Gen Z, and they partner up together to make 26.9% of the American population, and they are completely unaware of the fact they're the biggest. Boomers knew, okay? They knew. They everywhere they went, they saw children. There were children everywhere in the neighborhood, in schools. They were 40 into a kindergarten classroom, right? They were ear to ear. And so they knew there was a lot of them. But again, we always want what's best for our kid. And so we begin refining that. And as millennials come in, right, and there's a lot of them, we start just building new schools or adding portables, or right, all of that sort of stuff in order to keep our class size small, which is what the research was showing us, based on the Gen Xers, who were already half the size. You follow me on this? And then you've got Gen Alpha coming up in the back, and you're like, oh my gosh, they're huge. We're going to have two massive generations back to back. Fear not, we are not. The majority of millennials do not plan on having children. They're going to have dogs. Right? That's why you currently have full-grown adults walking around with I love my granddog sticker on the back. You know, my granddog got an 8.4, B-plus average in training school, right? So what all this kind of boils down to is that the larger percent of the American population at this point is not the older people. It is the millennials, right? Most of the people in the country are under 33 years of age, right? Which means we have to start looking at them now, not so much as a, you frustrate the heck out of me, but if I don't understand who you are, then I'm going to have a hard time moving forward with you. So that's what we're going to move on to next, is this idea of what makes us all so different. But not before I give you this very important bit of advice. No matter how much you want your kid to think like you, act like you, feel like you, walk like you, talk like you, they're still them. They're their own little person with their own pocket of messes that they get to make over the course of their life. There's no amount of wishing that's going to make that person live exactly the life that you dreamed for them during those 10 months that they were incubating, right? It's just not going to happen. And so you got to give yourself, especially as a parent, a little bit of an opportunity, right, to back off of that and say, you know, there are different people in different times with different circumstances, and some people literally have to stick their hand on the fire in order to learn, and my child is entitled to make their mistakes. They're allowed to make their mistakes within reason, within safety, right? But they're allowed, they are not you. They weren't raised in the same time as you. They didn't have the same pressures, right? Social media is its own dragon, which I understand you're going to be having a lesson on coming up very soon. Very different than what I had when I was 8, right? I get home, my parents weren't home for 4 more hours. I didn't have to tell my parents where I was going. I was just like, slam my homework down, bye, right? I was out in the neighborhood, and I would come home when the street lights came on, because that's when I was instructed to come home. Right? That's a huge difference between having watches that track your kids' every move. Right? That's a big difference. So let's get into this idea of points of difference. Where do we see some key differences between millennials, Gen Zs, and Gen Alphas that we don't see in the older generations? Okay? So one of the first places we see it is at the idea of our job and identity being linked. For the millennials, their job and their identity are not linked. If you've had any conversation with anyone in their 30s, basically at this point, they'll say, I have a job to make money to go do and buy the things I want. Right? It's not who I am. It doesn't define me as an individual. And that is quite a big difference. So here's what you got to know about why the baby boomers are the opposite of that. Their parents would have been the traditionalist, okay? And traditionalists would have been children during the Great Depression. So what becomes the most important thing in the world for their child to have? A job. And that kid doesn't have to feel happy or fulfilled or anything in any kind of way about that job. They must have a job. So because of the traditionalist circumstances, they put a new set of rules and pressures on their children, and that's where the baby boomers begin to link their job and their identity together. The perfect example is if you ever meet a baby boomer in the wild, right? That you will go through a ritual. This is all pre-COVID. Who knows how this is going to happen later on? But some of them are fighting really hard to not shake your hand right now, aren't they? So what happens is you meet somebody in their 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. You will go through a process. Stranger, I go up to them. I extend my hand, which none of this really makes sense now in light of COVID. That's a lot of germs and yuck, gross. So I extend my hand. We shake hands, right? If you're a baby boomer, you almost always pump three times. God bless America. You pump three times every time, right? Gen Xers will give you one pump because I didn't want to shake your hand, but I know it means something to you. Right? And millennials are like, hey, man, because they know about germs, right? They don't do any of that kind of stuff. So boomers are going to pump hands. God bless America. I say my name. You say your name. What's the next question always? What do you do for a living? So here's what you got to understand. Traditionalists train their children, the baby boomers, that every time they meet a stranger, they should affirm their worth and contribution to American society. So is that person ever going to get to a place where they're like, I used to be something and now I'm not? No, because we've proven very clearly what happens the minute you cease to be useful in American culture, right? We stick you in a home, okay? And boomers are like, you're not sticking me on a home. I'm the reason why there's a gym every three blocks in this city, right? I'm the one out there running down Bailey Cove every morning, okay? So a lot of, this is just a good example. So what happens is it becomes very important for boomers. Their job and their identity get interwoven. And then their children, the Gen Xers, feel the fallout from that because the job becomes so important. Keep the job at all costs, right? Becomes so important that the Gen Xers are like, oh, my mom missed all of my ballet recitals and she never brought me cupcakes to school and I'm not gonna do that, right? So what happens is the next group of kids, the Gen Xers felt neglected, so what do they do to their children? They overprotect, right? And then what will happen is the millennials will be like, my parents hovered over me 24/7. It was horrible. You, go play. Here's some weird funky gadget that will allow me to know where you are. Shoo. We're already even seeing that happen, right, with Gen Alphas. Most of us are like, we'll get them, I'll get you a cheap phone in some capacity. Just leave me alone, right? Go play, okay? So this job and identity thing is something that is always going to be in flux. Are you following me on that? In light of COVID, we don't really know what's going to happen to these coronials. Will there be a new push of have a job? Depends really on what happens financially to us as an overarching culture. Do you see? Everybody follow me on this? But job and identity are different. Your kids don't have, hear me, your kids do not have the same perspective on work that you do because they weren't raised with the same kind of pressure, right? Think about millennials. They were told, honey, just be whatever you want to be. Just be happy, right? And so they go up to their bosses, and they're like, I'm going to need 2 months in Peru because I just need to find myself, right? And Gen Xers are like, I would never. Well, that's because we were trained to buy as much crap as possible, and we can't afford our houses. So we can't walk away and take the trip to Peru. So instead, we spend all our time resenting the millennials for their trip to Purdue. Right, Purdue. Lord, that's different. Okay. Then we move into the next idea of views on competition. These are drastically different between the different generations. So, example for those of you who are Gen Xers and Zennials in the room, maybe even some baby boomers. When we grew up, there was a thing we played during recess called kickball, right? And it was cut tooth. Right? It was major. And so you would have really good kickball players that would be captains, and then everybody else would line up, and then we would playground pick, right? So there was a kid, his name was Jim Griffin. When I was in, I swear to y'all, second grade, he was 6 feet tall. He was 6 feet tall in second grade, and everybody knew that Jim Griffin was the best kickball player at Vestavia Elementary School. And everybody knew that Kristin was not. And that's because I looked like that, okay? My glasses were this big, which my mom assures me was the style, but I think she's a liar, okay? And so, you know what I didn't do? I didn't play kickball, because that wasn't my jam. I went over, remember, anybody else remember this? You found the thing that was your thing? I used to go over and make houses out of pine straw and boss people around, because I was super good at that. I didn't have to do the thing I wasn't good at, but that's not what we did to your children. That's not what we did with Gen Zs and Millennials and Gen Alphas. Instead, we said we're going to have a 2-week-long kickball unit. Everybody plays. Teacher feels sorry for Kristen's giant glasses because kids pick on her, and so makes her the captain. Now I have to play every single time. Right? We're not keeping score, so nobody's like high-fiving Jim Griffin. Way to go, Jim. You're the best in the world. Right? And if Jim gets too good, the coach might even walk up to him and say, you know what, you might want to tap that down. We don't want anybody feeling bad about themselves. Do you see how this confuses your viewpoint on excellence? Right? It was a good idea at the time, and it came from the baby boomers were real. If you're a Gen Xer, you played a sport. It didn't matter if you wanted to be a scientist, you played some kind of sport. Right? Because your parents were like, my kids are gonna. So you were raised very competitive, okay? And what happened is the younger sibling, those flower children, were like, it's too intense on my nephew and niece. When I have kids, I'm going to relieve them of all that pressure. And then we're going to go to participation trophies. And so that's what happens with the difference between the Zennials and the Millennials on participation trophies, right? The divide happens based on how intense the boomers were parenting their kids versus how free flow. Again, it comes down to the people who were the flower children. They got a book from Dr. Spock, right? And Dr. Spock's book comes out and he's like, feel the rhythm of your children, right? Stop beating them. Let them eat whenever they want to. Communicate. And so all these millennials are awesome at communicating all the time. Right? And all of us Zennials and Gen Xers are like, if I talked to my mom that way, it would have been a slap across the face. You with me on this? It's always going to come down to the norms. This is why. And so what's happened is, what's interesting is, so now those of you who are parents of Gen Alphas, you've now worked with Millennials who all got the participation trophies, and you're like, no, not my kid. Right? And so you put them in travel ball at like third grade, right? In order to beef up their competition. So you have this weird world of those Gen Alphas that step in a world between, in some parts of my life, there is no competition. Competition is extremely discouraged. And then in other parts of my life, it's be the best beyond all else. It's because of where we are in the pendulum swing. You follow me on this? So this is why your older child might have a totally different viewpoint on competition than your younger child is going to have. Another thing I wanted to add on to this is that there used to be a term for millennial parents, and that was helicopter parents. Do you remember that idea? The idea that they would hover above them and tell them what to do. We call parents of Gen Zs and Gen Alphas lawnmower parents. They just mow anything out of the way that might cause their child to stumble. They just go in front of them, right? They're not going to do it for them, but they're going to make that ride smooth, right? And so that, again, again, is not always the best way to do it, because they're going to have bosses who have a very different perspective, and if they can't handle someone else paving the way for them and they have to mow their own grass, it might be big drama, just like it was with millennials. Okay? All right. The next thing, this is, if you don't get anything else, listen to me. If you don't listen to anything else this whole presentation, I want you to implement struggle time in your house. Heather Morse will tell you it is one of the most brilliant ideas in the history of the world. And it actually comes from a teacher at Weatherly Heights Elementary School in South Huntsville. And her name is Joni Ogle. She was my daughter's third grade teacher. And my daughter came home and told me about this, and I became friends with Joni later on. And so now I just always give credit where credit's due, right? So here's the thing. What Joni does is she teaches a new concept. And then she looks at the children and she says, okay, everybody, struggle time. And for the next 30 minutes, nobody can ask her any questions. Nobody can ask each other any questions. They can't go to any kind of online resources. They just struggle to figure it out, right? That if you will please start saying to your children, struggle time, every so often, you will make them much better human beings. Because there are bosses across this country where every time a young employee runs up against something they don't know, they interrupt the flow of the next person, the boss's day, right? Because it's like, well, what do I do now? And how should I do this? And I don't. And you're like, you are the best Googler in the office. You can do it. Right? So when your kids call and they're like, Mom, I don't know how to do this, you say, hey, baby, struggle time. In about 30 minutes, if you don't have it figured out, call me back. And don't touch your phone. Click. Right? You let them struggle. Struggling's good for you. Struggling's how you grow, how you really learn. If I give you all the answers as your parent, what happens when you become an adult and there's no one there to give you the answers? Right? It's not good for you. We are teaching. That's what I told the students today. The way that you practice, anybody got, y'all got athletes in your house? And I tell them, I've got my little 9-year-old's an athlete. And I tell them all the time, the way that you practice is how you will play. And childhood is practice for adulthood. You get opportunities to fall, scrape your knees, mess up, blow conversations, not be best friends with your best friends anymore when you're a child, so that hopefully as you become an adult, you can have healthy relationships that are full of communication, that where you've learned from there those mistakes. Same thing here. You got to prep them. They are going to play the way that they are practicing right now. Okay? When my daughter has a problem with a teacher, I never get involved. Never. Never. I will never get involved because I have no intention when she's in college of ever contacting their professor and telling them, my kid's grade's wrong, right? Because as that person who is the professor who has been contacted, it dramatically impacted the way that I looked at that child from then on. If I'm just honest, I looked at that person differently and I started thinking, ooh, baby, I'm not sure you're gonna make it. Right? Instead of believing in them, I would much rather be challenged and have good assertions and have people be able to make their case than have you come and get involved in any way. And as they get older, they should be able to solve their own stuff. Right? Because here's the thing. At 18, the United States of America says, I can pluck you up and send you to war. So to me, you're grown. And so I need to do everything I can as your parent to allow you to practice how you're going to play. Okay? Views on excellence is a huge difference between the generations. The best example I can give you is the idea of the science fair. So for those of you who are baby boomers and are Gen Xers, do you remember when there used to be science and social studies fairs? And there was literally one instruction for you for that thing, wasn't it? This is the day it's due. That's it. It was up to you to figure out how you were going to make your own potato clock, right? Is that what your children have experienced? No. Instead, what happens, and I'm not blaming the school system. This is just reactionary. We always do things that are reactionary, okay? And so what happens is now, if there's a science fair, your child will get a handout that will say, here's how big your trifold board needs to be, and here's what color it needs to be if it's in chemistry instead of biology, and here's how many sentences each point needs to have, and here's a YouTube video on how to make a potato clock, and then we'll have an after-school class on how to make potato clocks together, right? And I'll send your parent resources if I need to. They've been kind of trained, forced really, by the overarching idea of school. This is not from school to school. This is the overarching idea, to give them as much information as possible, even so much as giving them rubrics. Rubrics are the bane of my existence in college, okay? Because what a rubric does, it says, if you want to get an A, you'll do all these things. Tick, 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 tick. If you want to get a B, you'll do all these things. C, D, right? Now here's the problem. How many rubrics are you giving to your employees? Zero. Zero. Right? You're giving them job descriptions that aren't even accurate depictions of what they're going to do. Because there's that horrible sentence that says, and other duties as assigned. Right? So what's happened is we have now trained a whole generation of millennials, Gen Zs, and Gen Alphas that we're going to have very specific syllabi, instructions, there's going to be timelines pre-built, all of this is going to be here, and they get it literally up to college. Right? And then they walk into the workplace and say, give me my gold star for being here. And we're like, yeah, no, we don't do that. So go make it work, kid. Right? And this is part of why they bounce so fast. Because if they don't get enough positive feedback early on, then they're like, oh, nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. I got to go. And that's why currently across the country, because of COVID, because COVID changes things. But every 18 months, millennials were on average shifting jobs every 18 months, which is killer for HR. And it's not good for your budget at all, right? So we got to understand that sometimes things just don't have answers. Like I tell my students all the time, they'll say, well, what's the rubric on this? And I'll say, the rubric is be good, be the best that you can be, push yourself further than you did last speech. That's the rubric. A is excellent, B is good. But what makes it B is good? Good is good. If you just do what's on the syllabus, then that's a C. Because they don't know what excellence is anymore. Do you see what I'm saying? It's good to be pushing them and giving. Sometimes you give them a task to do and you give them no instructions whatsoever. And you say, "You do your best. Do your best." We've got to push them to learn how to do their best. Another thing, and especially baby boomers, you will remember this. I'm going to use Jerry over here. There used to be, when you would take a test in elementary school, okay, or high school, middle school, what would happen would be the teachers would write the full names of the students and their grades, and they would take that piece of paper and they would stick it on the door outside of the classroom, right? Preferably on the way to PE or to the lunchroom. And so everybody who's walking by, standing in line, right, would look at that list and they'd be like, "Ooh, Jerry got a 32. Right? There was some level of public shaming that was maybe a little too intense there. But here's the bottom line. By them knowing, right, other people's grades, they knew where they stood. Right? Now, millennials through college never saw each other's grades. Have no clue. Gen Zs have no clue. No idea where they stand. So, of course, they think they're the best. They're awesome. They're killer because they don't see how they actually stack up in the range. And that ain't happening anytime soon in the American school system. So don't get excited, right? But what I'm saying is that sometimes it's good for you to teach your child that they're not going to be the best at every single thing they do. And that's fine. If you look at people who are some of the most brilliant leaders in the world, they know what they're awesome at. And then they hire people that around them that are awesome at their thing. They don't feel like they have to be the best of the best of the best. Right? They know, I'm awesome, just like Gen Xers did. Most any of you would say, if I did a questionnaire and I said, are you awesome at math? You'd know. Are you great at reading? You'd know. Art, music, you would be able to be like, yes, because very clearly, somewhere in your childhood, you had a teacher that was like, no, baby, this is not your thing. Right? Move on. You might be awesome at reading. Let's go do that. Okay? So that was much more clear. So now the problem is that you have a group of people, a rather large group of people, based on, right, what we've got the census, that have an inflated self-esteem. Okay? So here's the problem if you have a falsely inflated self-esteem. The minute you realize you're not the best in the world, it is soul crushing. It takes you down in a different way. And that's what part of why we're seeing so many mental health issues springing up even earlier in young people's lives. Not just because we can name them, because that does give us some advantage to be able to point to it and say these behaviors are these. But the bottom line is that when you have a world on Snapchat, Instagram, whatever it is, that's telling you you have to dress a certain way, look a certain way, act a certain way. And we had that with television, but at least we could turn it off, right? They got a buzzer jolting them every 20 seconds, right? So the pressure is different for that particular generation of people. So you had grades on the door for your older generation, and now you've got a whole group of people that don't actually know what they're the best at all. And if you got a really mean mom, you could be the best at everything, right? So it distorts you. The next concept is this idea of views on intelligence. So this is quite interesting. The internet comes along and it completely shreds the way that we almost divide in half across the generations on how we view intelligence, okay? So for people who are in the older generations, baby boomers, traditionalists, and I would even put Gen X, the first part of that, is gonna fall into this category, okay? Intelligence is based on being able to prove you know what you know, right? So this is why this group of people are far more focused on what your degree is in, where it came from, how many years of experience you have, how many letters happen before or after your name, right? They're very interested in your being able to prove that you are smart on paper, okay? But here's what's interesting. Then we get the internet, right? In Zennials, we all get AOL. Every Zennial can tell you exactly what dial-up internet sounds like. Eeeeeee, right? We know immediately. And what happens is the Netscape is born and Google is born. And now you've got a group of people that don't even have to spell words correctly. And they can find experts from all around the world. So the older generation, they were all trained, you go to a person, you go to a human that can prove that they're smart, and that's your primary resource. And then if you can't figure it out, then you go to additional resources. But that is not what this generation was designed to do. They were told, you go to your resources, and if you still can't figure it out, then you go to a human, right? And like, just think about it for us, you know, for the older generations, we couldn't even get a book because they had things like this in our library. And the Dewey Decimal System was so complicated, we still had to go find a librarian, an expert, to find a book, right? But now they've got the computer and they can type it right in and they can get information at their fingertips. So intelligence shifts. Now it doesn't matter what you know, it matters if you know where to go to get information. It's all about resources. And this causes a lot of conflict in families because parents, right, were trained, you just memorize your multiplication tables. You don't have to understand the why, right? And the millennials are like, well, because I watched 3 TED Talks and had a YouTube video that helped me on that. Okay? It's a difference on intelligence. So we talked about that. Views on independence, just rattling through. Gen Zs, we were latchkey kids, right? We handled our business. Right? I'll give you an example. I tell my kids this all the time. When I was in first grade, I walked home to an empty house, right? I got my key it was almost a mile to my house from my elementary school. I got a key from around my neck, right? And I unlocked the door. And if I lost that key, my life was over. Because according to my parents, to rekey the house was $1 billion, okay? And then I would go to my house and I would get an apple, and the apple was not pre-peeled, and the apple was not pre-cored, and the apple was not organic, and somehow we all magically did not die, right? And then with the sharpest knife that my 6-year-old hands could find, I would hack into the apple, and if I cut my pinky off, my parents were not coming home for 3 more hours, and the phone was literally bolted to the wall on the other side of the room, right? And then I would go to the pantry, and I would get a vat of Jif Extra Crunchy peanut butter out, right? And I didn't worry about the saturated fats, and I didn't worry about the sugar level, and I didn't worry if anybody that I was playing out in the street with was going to have a peanut allergy. Right? And then I would sit down and I would do my homework. Right? And I had 6 whole weeks to pull myself together. 6 whole weeks. And so if I made a bad grade on my spelling test, I just shoved it to the bottom of the backpack. But that is not a luxury your children have, because they get an email that's to the parents that say, hey, by the way, your kid stunk today. Figure that out, right? So you see how that changes the ability to formulate your own grades and understand how to get your excellence and how to come around with extra credit. I would have been the one as a six-year-old going to my teacher and said, man, I bombed that. Can I like bang erasers or something to get extra credit? That was on me. You with me on this? So there's a huge difference on independence, a huge difference on how we've set people up. And, you know, as we have become more and more flexible, and as we have more and more parents who are able to work from home or leave at earlier times, what we can't sacrifice is our children's independence. We still need to make sure they know how to take care of themselves when they leave, which please God do. Right? Okay. So the opposite of that would be today's idea of a cell phone tracker or a watch tracker, or, right? Where they literally, the first time they got it, you were like, okay, honey, if you're going to go out and play with your friends, every time you get to a street sign, text mommy, let her know you're still alive, right? And our parents did not hear from us for hours, days on the weekends, and nobody called an Amber Alert. Right? They just called your friends, and they figured if we did get snatched, it's cool, we'll just make a new one. Right? Very different perspective all the way around. And this is part of why your kids don't have the same striving for independence, and part of why we are not seeing anywhere near as many students desperate to get their driver's license. That's always one of the things that I hear people confounded about, because for all of us, it was the sign of freedom. The hot minute you could do it, you were out. And now you've got kids that are 17 that are like, yeah, I'm good, because they don't have to get to work in the same way. They don't have to be able to go to a location to hang out with their friends. They can literally put out their cell phones and FaceTime. So it's going to change the way that they view the world. I kind of hate to miss this one, but I'm going to. Okay. The big thing you need to know about this is that younger people don't look busy. Okay? They don't fake busy. Older people do. Gen X or Zennials, every one of us know exactly what our boss sounds like when they walk down the hall. Exactly, right? And we hear them walking down the hall, and we go from like, I'm working, to like, I'm working! Look at me work! Hey, Jerry, just over here working, right? And then Jerry goes to the cubicle next door, and the millennial's like, sup? Right? And you're like, you stupid child, what have you done to us? Now he's going to walk around all day long. Right? So this is a big thing. So no child left behind in some ways changes, right, this idea of even looking busy. Part of why we do that, those older generations even bother to fake busyness, is because when we were in school, we used to get assigned a packet. I don't know if any of you remember this. You have a packet for the whole week of school, and your teacher would have them in the boxes. And so you basically worked on your own time schedule. You would you'd do your work, and then you would go put it, turn it in, and then she'd say, great, get another piece, right? And you'd work your way through your week. But when No Child Left Behind happens with Bush, you no longer cannot have people on the same topic at the same time. Right? So instead what happens is for millennials and Gen Zs and Gen Alphas, they work as fast as they can on the piece of work, and then they just chill. They've got free time until the teacher moves on to the next topic. They're used to hurry up and wait. Hurry up and wait. So you have a generation that was trained, always look like you're finding the next thing to do or you're out of here, versus a generation of people that are like, why are you mad I got done fast? Right? You also have to remember that this is part of why your younger people will not take the initiative. They'll see a nasty house, and until you say, go do it, they won't do it. Because they weren't trained to look busy. They don't know how bad it could get. They're used to, you finish a piece of work, and then the teacher tells you when you move on to the next piece of work. You see how this is going to change the way that they interact with you? It's not so much defiance as it is a cultural norm. All right, so here's what I want to know from you on the last poll here, if you're just interested in staying in it. Your text number should be the same. Where did you learn the most today? Is there a topic that really stood out to you personally and you thought, okay, I can't apply everything today, but this one particular thing I think I'm going to start to implement in my life? You'll go to 22333, our school, 482. And then you'll put in A for job and identity, B, competition, C, excellence, D, intelligence, E, independence, or F, looking busy? What's going to be the thing that's going to be your prime takeaway from tonight's lesson? I'll give you just a second to do that. Good. Already people liking the idea of excellence versus intelligence. Excellence and intelligence, rather. Grab your reading glasses. You can do it. Get your kid to text it for you. They've got speeds of fire, thumbs of fire. Oh, I would love for it to hit on all of them. That would be great, right? Everyone learned something tonight. That's what I'm interested in. Oh, good. Independence. We'll give you just one or two more minutes. If it doesn't move soon, then we'll just forget it and move on. All right. Are they on the live stream? Sorry, y'all. Have they gotten to the poll at all there on the live stream? No. Okay. Well, for those of you that are in here already, in a second we're going to move on to questions. Right? And there'll be a place for you to do that. So if you have a question that's starting to bubble up in your head already, you can go ahead and start thinking of what you're going to put into that. He's going to give you a code in just a little bit that's going to allow them to do that. Okay. Giving those people just a second. So that's basically y'all in the room, right? Reflected. You might be the only people even still on. All right. Shall we call it? Okay. Boom, deuces. That's fine. At least you learned. Aren't you glad you're here? Okay? So we're going to give you a little bit of time to come up with some questions, things that might be interesting to you. There is a way to do this, again, on poll everywhere. And, of course, for anybody that's live, we can hand you a microphone and you can ask away if you want. Some of you are like, I just would like to go eat, and so I am done with this, and that's okay, too. but if you do have questions, I do want to make sure that you feel like they are getting answered. So, again, you can use that same thing you just did and text our school 482, and then pop your question in there, and you'll see if anything starts showing up. Anybody in the house that got any questions? Or you're like, I'm just glad I know it's not me. Do it now? You're typing them. Look at you, clever. You can just say it if you want to, Heather.
I've got a question.
Okay, go for it.
With the impact of COVID-19, especially back in March, when we sent everybody home and we sent everybody to be with your family, what do you see is going to come out of that, where it was kind of mandated that everybody was home together? What do you see is going to happen with our children?
Well, I think one of the things is it's going to depend very much on how healthy the family was during that time, right? If the dynamic was not good at the family at home, I think you're going to see children from across the country that are going to have a very high impact to where, you know, some of those basic things they had, like food, care, responsibility, they didn't receive those things. But I think for people that were in a healthy family situation, that they're going to be significantly closer to their parents. I think we should see that happen where we had a long period of time where we were able to spend time, and it wasn't like an intense, we got to take a picture of everything you do and cram as much into one time as we can. We had an extended period of time to kind of get to know one another a little bit more. So we should see a closeness resurface, and we also should see a tighter bond grow between grandparents and grandchildren. That should be one of the most intense bonds that ends up happening, especially if the grandparents had to stay removed during this year and they previously had a very close relationship with those people. You'll see a lot of intensity. I think you'll also see a lot of people being more intentional about handing down stories, right? Making sure anytime you get sort of reminded of your potential to pass away, you start trying to secure your legacy much faster. So I think you'll see a lot of that, those kinds of exchanges happening. I think a lot of people for Christmas will get those books that's like, here's the story of my life, right? That sort of stuff I think you're going to see. But for people that were in a healthy family, right, they should become closer. For people that were maybe not in the best situation, or their family was already on the brink of a split up or right relationships happening, it definitely could have soured their perspective on their family. So it really just is going to depend on how many people were healthy and how many were in a bad place. Because we're already seeing that shake out, aren't we? We're seeing those divorces that we thought might happen after a year of COVID are like, they're cranking out pretty fast. It was definitely sort of a bone-shaking test in a way I think many people didn't have. You got some more questions for me?
Got another question. Great. From our audience. Why do Gen Z talk over others, not respect social norms of polite conversation?
Okay, well, part of that is because they're still young and stupid, and they haven't got slapped down for it as much. Many of us, for people who are Gen Xers and baby boomers, if you spoke over your elders, the whole table would go silent, right? And then someone there would correct you and say, shut your face, you're a child, you don't speak when the adults are talking. So that's one element, is that we kind of have allowed that to happen more, because we do want our children to have their own opinions. We want them to be able to vocalize those in a good way. But I think actually a lot of this has to do with social media, where they are accustomed to having large amounts of input come at them very, very quickly and being able to respond instantaneously to every single thing that is said. And so the problem is that it doesn't lend a lot of practice time to the idea of thinking your whole idea through before you put it out there. And that was pushed much harder on the Gen Xers and the boomers, this idea of think about it before you say it, because you're not going to be able to take it back. Right? And here you've got a generation of people that have seen horrible stuff be said over social media, and then people be like, okay, I'm just going to delete those tweets, and then it was like it never happened. Right? But all those kids are still sitting around, like I said earlier today, they're still sitting around being like, yeah, but Kanye's crazy. Right? He can delete all those texts, but you can't actually get it back. But I think a lot of the talk over happens from being inundated with, especially with snaps move so fast, right? It moves so fast. TikToks, 30 seconds, right? Very little time to let you actually process what you think. And if you've watched your children on Instagram, they don't even really look at the pictures anymore. They just heart, right? They're not even engaging with people anymore. And that heart is a means of communication for them. It is a means of speaking. Right? That poo-poo sign or whatever thing the emoji is that they're using, that's one of the things that is a speaking. So it's not going to be uncommon that they're going to ignore those social norms. And all of us when we were teenagers thought we were the smartest in the world. We didn't know that our frontal lobe had not really developed yet. We all thought our parents were stupid, right? We all did that. It's just that their platform's so much stinking bigger. They just have an ability to get a voice out in a way that we did not. Next question.
Got another question. It sounds like maybe it is more important to understand these groups than to try and change them.
Oh, yes. So I don't know if you followed all that, this idea of it's maybe better to understand where these people are coming from than to try to change them. Trying to change them is not going to work. So it's funny, like, people will be like, well, don't you think as people age, they begin to conform? Have you met somebody that's a true hippie? They're not conforming, right? They're the ones still standing on the corner of airport every single Saturday, right? In the bone-chilling cold. Those things that are our core parts don't really change. They don't really change. Now, we get better at tempering our, right? We get bruised and beat up and battered, and we learn little lessons along the way that way. But a lot of these core things that we're seeing, views on intelligence, views on excellence, views on job and identity, those are going to be core values that continue to stay along with each one of these generations as they continue to go through. So I think that's why you're going to see, you're not going to want to hear this, but you're going to see this push, especially as more Xennials and Millennials start companies, you're going to see them care significantly less about degrees. That's going to start to go away very, very fast. Because what most Gen Zs and Millennials and Xennials are interested in is, how fast can I teach you? Are you teachable? Can you do what I need you to do quickly? Right? And so they're looking at their, you know, $400,000 degree and saying, man, I'm never getting out from underneath this. And this kid right here can work just as fast as I can straight out of high school, right? So I think we're going to see a little bit of that. And then also, this is the first generation, really the Gen Z, is the first generation since the GI Bill was instituted, where parents have started to get okay again with people going back into trades, right? And that's partially because we are paying outrageous amounts of money for plumbing and electricity, and right? And so that's sort of the idea of, dude, if school's not your thing, that is one very expensive pair of adult training wheels, right? So if you don't need it and this is your jam, go do it. We're kind of looking at it in a different way. And that's purely pendulum swing from GI to millennials. We went for the two extremes. Almost every millennial you'll talk to went to some sort of degree granting something. Yep.
One other question. Sure. It appears in your presentation that the generational attitudes are fixed or set. Is it possible that they might evolve?
It's possible, right? This is what I got to refer to this to over and over again is, man, we don't know what COVID's about to do to all this, right? All you have when you do generational theory, all you have is the ability to pivot backwards and look for patterns, right? And so now we're in a place that the pivot was so extreme, right? It was like post-World War II extreme. And it's the first time we've had that level of extreme in 100 years. Okay, so right now I can look at it and be like, yeah, I don't think that's ever going to change. And I do think core things will happen, but I do think that COVID will have a massive impact in the same way. And again, people come into your life and they challenge your viewpoint. I mean, almost every person I know, like in their relationship, like one of them's a messy and one of them's a clean, right? And they start off their relationship in war over those two things. And over time, they move to the middle, right? One gets a little less messy and one gets a little less freaked out about it not being perfectly clean. Or you've got a spender and a saver, right? People come together. So just the people you surround yourself by, the books you read, and your commitment to be a lifelong learner and develop yourself as a person, you should be constantly evolving. But there are certain things that we can look at right now and say, these are key mindsets for a majority in this particular moment in time. In all, right, when we're looking at generations, we're looking at a day snapshot. And what I was talking about, oh Lord, a year ago, literally, like today, a year ago was the last presentation live that I had given. Because everything went blank, right? March 13th, Alabama shut down. And so it changed and it evolved. And so, yeah, life events are going to come in and change things, and nothing's impossible. We hope that we continue to change and grow as individuals. But I think there are key tenets that we can look at and say, my grandma's still washing every single piece of aluminum foil like it's the Great Depression. She's probably not going to throw away those bolts either, right? There's some guesses that you can make. Right? Good? Okay. Well, I hope you feel like this was informative to you today and that you feel like you understand the people in your life at least a little bit better. You're not going to spend any more time trying to force them to be something that they're not, but you're going to help them learn from your big giant mistakes that you have made over the course of your life. I wish you and your children and your community and Randolph the absolute best of luck in whatever it is that you choose to do in the future. And I am 100% available. Can I go over to my last little slide here? Because obviously you can't get a business card from me today if you learned a whole lot. If you want to learn more, right, then you can absolutely take a screenshot or to grab your phone or whatever it is that you want to do and get sort of a virtual screenshot here to learn more from me. At the very least, I would love to hook up with you on LinkedIn and just see what you thought and what you learned and did it change your viewpoint on anything. And then there's all kinds of social medias, and then you can go to genwy.com and see some other videos and learn a little bit more. But I'm 100% available to be able to work with you, your organization, maybe not your individual kid, because that's a little intense and would be very expensive for you. But I would love to continue this conversation with you, and I thank you all very much for your time tonight. Jerry, do you have anything else that you want to tell them before we get done? Thank you again, guys, so much. I appreciate you.
Kristin, thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. We thank our audience for joining us this evening. We hope you'll join us next Tuesday at 6:30, and we'll be showing a documentary, Screenagers, next chapter, followed by a conversation after that. Have a great evening. Thank you.